Hello, a very good afternoon, and thank you all for being here for this session. It's a very special session where we are launching the first anthology of scholarly work on Rituparno Ghosh, who, as most of you know, was considered one of the most significant filmmakers, not just in Bengal, but in India. He was a trendsetter, he became an icon himself, and he was multifaceted, an auteur who wrote his scripts, who directed 20 films in 20 years of his long career. And besides that, did a lot of other writing as well, and had a very, very strong influence on Bengali culture. So we're going to talk very briefly about that, but I'd like to thank Javed Akhtar Saab for being here this afternoon to launch the book for us. And we'd like to have a few words from him before. And I'd like to introduce Kaustav Bakshi, my co-editor, and one of the contributors in the book, Onugyan Nag, who's written one of the essays and who will moderate later when we take questions from you. So Javed Saab, if you'd like to say a few words about... Sure.
Hello everybody, this is the third book I am releasing in last 2 days. So, and this is also a book that I have not read. Releasing books that I have not read is becoming my career. Fortunately, I know the writer and I know the writer, director, Rituparno Ghosh. I knew him well. So it's really a privilege to release this book. You know, they believe that art and all kind of creativity takes place in a situation of paradox. I'll give you an example, which is very physical, so you'll understand. Suppose a person is playing Hamlet on the stage. Obviously, the actor has to convince himself that he is Hamlet, and he is a person who cannot take decisions, who has a fickle mind, and so on. But at the same time, while he's speaking his lines, he has to reach a particular mark that the director has given him. So he has to do two things which are ostensibly contradictory, incompatible. Believe that he is Hamlet, and remember the chalk mark. It's contradictory. But that is how art is created, in such contradictions. I think what is so beautiful about Rituparno Ghosh, that this paradox, why should we say contradiction, paradox, is so very beautiful in his work, I see. He is modern, he is contemporary, but at the same time, in spite of being a very talented writer himself, he takes Tagore's story, like Nauka Dubi, like Chokar Bali, he takes O. Henry, in Raincoat. So somewhere on one side, when you see the way he treats this story, the way he shoots them, he is spreading out. But in his 20 films, you can see the more he is spreading out, the deeper his roots are getting into the soil. Perhaps that is the ideal thing to happen to all of us. What happens that we don't bother about our roots, and we keep on spreading, and that if the tree doesn't have deep roots and is spreading, it will fall down. This is a beautiful paradox that I see in his work, that he is making things contemporary in today's language, but relating with the culture, with the history, with the tradition. Sangeeta Datta is a very dear friend, and I have great respect for her, because whatever she does with certain degree of perfection. She is a very good singer. She gave lectures on Rabindra Sangeet. She is a professor of English literature and has taught English in England. That's rather an achievement. And together we have made an album, Anant, where she selected 8 songs of Tagore, and I translated those songs to the same tune original tune. Not only that they are translation, but they are translated to the original tunes of Tagore. And I could see that how hard she has worked on it. And I'm sure that a person who always strives for perfection and certain excellence will definitely must have done a very good job in the book. So happy reading to all of you. Thank you very much. And now I'll take your permission, because after this, I have my session and I'll talk about the books that I have written, not only read. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Javed Saab. To come back to this book, Rituparno Ghosh, Cinema, Gender and Art, the book is published by Routledge, and we are very, very happy to be here at Jaipur Literary Festival in the front lawns. I know if Rituparno had been with us today, he would have been massively thrilled that his book is opening up to such a large audience here. But coming back to Rituparno Ghosh and the particular time when he started working in Bengali cinema, he is generally considered the inheritor of Satyajit Ray's legacy, the inheritor of what we understand as intellectual cinema. When we went through the movements of alternate cinema and parallel cinema, cinema emerging from Bengal, cinema emerging from Kerala, and other strong regional cinema industries, they were really and rapidly making their mark on Indian cinema history. Now that legacy or that tradition was what in many ways Rituparno extended. But when he started making films which were about family stories which he would subvert, family stories in which he would question patriarchal values and hegemonies, family stories where he was certainly picking up feminist issues and bringing them up in a pertinent manner, they were small films. He was restricted with his budgets. He had wonderful writing talent and therefore attracted the best talent in the industry. So he was always fortifying his narratives with strong actors. And that was the first chapter or the first episode of his career. After which, when he started winning national awards every year, he became a name not just in Bengal, but in the rest of India. And even outside India, there was a huge interest in Rituparno Ghosh's cinema. He did always say that he was making films for... He was making middle-class stories. He was a boy who came out of a middle-class family with parents who were artists, with a very, very strong artistic, aesthetic eye which he brought into his cinema in many ways. It's only when he started becoming a bigger name and he was attracting more funds and producers that he moved into his second chapter of his career, where the bigger films started happening and he was inviting talent from Bombay to come and work in Calcutta. So there was Aishwarya Rai cast in Chokhir Bali. There was Abhishek Bachchan, Ajay Devgan, and these films happened back to back, Raincoat, Antar Mahal, each of them wonderful films, traveling to all the film festivals internationally, winning awards. And that was the second creative phase where Ritu had access to budgets and funds and a creative team with whom he could widen his cinematic vision. I worked as associate director with him during this very exciting second phase when the horizons were expanding and a pretty much dying, impoverished Bengali industry was again breathing, getting oxygen, getting money, getting work. And you could see a whole industry there beginning to really stand up on its feet again. And it's incredible that just one man, one filmmaker could do this, could really turn around an industry on his own. But he was doing that because he was making one film a year, sometimes more than a film in a year. And then there was the very interesting third phase, which in a way was more autobiographical, in a way much more about him coming out, dealing with subjects of alternate sexuality, dealing with sensitive ideas of gender, dealing with subjects which were considered taboo in the middle class milieu, in the middle class family space. So he was politicizing that very familiar family space of parents and children, of friends and relatives, and bringing in wonderfully inflected questions about gendered identity. Today, you know, very rapidly we've gone through this whole phase where we're talking about a lot of ideas far more openly. Younger people who are different or who have sexual orientations which are different don't really need to hide and suffer. There is a very open discourse outside about this. It's sad that Ritu really was before this time, and he took a very long time to come out with his identity and celebrate it at the end with films like Chitrangada. I'd like to pass the mic on to Kaustav, who is one of my co-editors. Rohit Dasgupta has gone back to London. But it's been a wonderful partnership working on this book. We all do books, you know. We do books sometimes out of compulsion. We do books because they are commissioned. I think this book was a book of love and a book of pure passion where, in a way, for all of us who were dealing with this vacuum of Ritu's sudden absence and shocking absence, it was a way of putting our thoughts together and making an assessment of a very important, I won't even say he's a filmmaker, a very important artist in our cultural space.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. And launching a book on Rituparno is kind of a passionate work that we did. It has been like two years that we have been working on this book. Ritu, as Sangeeta Di pointed out, was very close to us, and he had a major impact on the regional film industry. And not only that, he also emerged as an icon very, very early in his life. Sangeeta Di talked about Ritu's contribution to middle-class Bengali cinema. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that Ritu has been extremely important figure in the LGBT movement in India, and Ritu's films, his sensibilities, his writings, and all the discourses he associated himself with contributed significantly to the gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender movement. In fact, Rituparno Ghosh has been looked upon as an iconic figure, a public figure who could actually come out boldly, unambiguously, and make his sexuality extremely conspicuous. As we wrote this book, we kept in mind that Ritu's feminist and queer politics are focused on simultaneously with his contribution to the dynamics of regional film industry. And when we started to do this book, we were very taken aback by the fact that he was known by almost all the remarkable scholars of cinema across the globe. And because it's very difficult to imagine Ritu as a regional film director, he was actually very global in his politics, and his films too had a major impact in changing people's perspectives on minorities. And when I say minorities, I'm not just talking about sexual minorities, but definitely he also talked about marginalization. He talked about peripheral identities, which have been more and more focused in all his films. In fact, his films were very interesting social documents of liberating the new woman. You know, the idea of the new woman which emerged in modern Bengal, and the evolution of the new woman is excellently charted in all his films. If you look at his filmography, the way his films have progressed, he has moved from a middle-class feminist politics to a more iconoclastic queer politics. And the way and the whole trajectory has been a very interesting one. In fact, Rituparno Ghosh has been the butt of laughter. He has been ridiculed. He has been criticized. But he was somebody who could actually, he believed in his identity so much. And, you know, he was someone who never walked a pride march. He wasn't someone who actually came out on a queer platform and talked about the LGBT movement. He said that his queer politics was cultural and it should be transmitted through his films. So the cultural texts which Rituparno Ghosh has produced today, apart from being very important contribution to middle class cinema, are also extremely important cultural texts as far as the LGBT movement in India is concerned. I believe I have, I think the book which we have written, we have focused on these two major aspects of Ritu, apart from many other factors, of course. And I'm not, we are not claiming that this is an all-encompassing book, but this will definitely inaugurate an avenue to critically examine Rituparno more. Yeah. On to Onugyan Nag, who has contributed an article on Rituparno Ghosh in this volume, where he talks about his important role in the dynamics of Toliganj film industry, the industry.
First of all, I would like to congratulate both Sangeeta Datta and Kaustav Bakshi for, conceiving this project and giving me an opportunity to contribute an article for this book. And we have been waiting with bated breath, and finally the book sees the light of the day today. So I'm delighted, extremely thrilled and happy, and I feel very honored and proud. You know, both of you have kind of given us an introduction about who Rituparno was, what his work was, and I'm sure most of you are familiar with the kind of work he was engaged with. But I want to draw the attention of all of us back to the book and ask both of you if you could just kind of give us a little bit more detail about what the book has. Is it only about Rituparno as a cultural figure, or is it more about his films? What are the different kind of things that the book engages with? So I think that would interest the audience.
Like I said, Rituparno Ghosh was a multifaceted personality. And I think the book in many ways reflects that, because we deal with several aspects of Ritu and his filmography. There are quite straightforward textual analytical essays on some of his films. Films like, his adaptations of Tagore's Chokir Bali and his adaptation of Tagore's Nauka Dubi. There are scholarly essays on these. There are also these themes which creep up in Ritu's films, whether it's, as I said, his earlier feminism. He did couch himself behind feminism before he dealt with alternate sexuality in a bolder manner later on in his life. But we do deal with these. And for instance, in my essay, although I've written on Abohuman, which is one of my favorite films, I've also explored the idea of phenotia and how, with an artist, there are certain concerns and certain leitmotifs and certain ideas that a writer or a filmmaker continuously works on and evolves. And they creep up in different narratives in different stages of one's career. I find that very absorbing. I find Ritu's evoking of Indian mythology, although he's dealing with the contemporary, like Javed Saab said, he's dealing with contemporary stories of a household like yours and mine, but he is in the process also reminding us of a very, very long tradition and a long heritage of alternate sexuality, which really goes back to texts like even the Mahabharata. So he was a very, very fine scholar. His day would start at 4:35 in the morning, when he would sit and read and write and research. And this evoking of mythology, evoking of, or even in a way almost, sort of strengthening his own argument by going back to Indian history. Later on in life, the way in which he cross-dressed quite openly and wore jewelry and wore makeup and wore flamboyant clothes and became a fashion icon, he was constantly reminding us of the fact that men also did dress up earlier in Indian tradition. This wasn't something new. It was something which you could evoke and look for in history and find. So I loved the way in which he would go back and pull out even images of Chaitanya Dev as a very radical, as a very revolutionary musical singer who questioned established religious institutions, the way he would evoke Buddha as the very androgynous, very nurturing character of wisdom. There were all these ideas that were coming up, and for younger audiences and for readers who read his weekly editions of the Sunday magazine, of a very popular Sunday magazine, he was in many ways really a constructor of Bengali culture the way we know it. And that's why the vacuum is not just in cinema. When somebody comes in and really gives you a new way of looking at art, of looking at writing, of looking at cinema, of looking at the world around you, and suddenly at a very young age he's gone, then there is really a huge vacuum to deal with. And it's difficult to, we keep saying that he's irreplaceable, but it's also a hopeful picture where younger people are also able to expand those horizons.
Cost of your views.
Ask a question. Okay. The book looks at certain philosophical aspects of Ritu's films, where I guess Sangeeta Di talks at length on the idea of death in his films, and death and also changing identities. Most of his, and of course, while he was evoking the mythological historiography of, queer identities and feminist identities, he was at the same time, representing the contemporary city, the modern metropolis life in a very interesting way. And he had actually given a makeover to what we today call chamber drama in cinema. Most of his films are actually shot indoors. Many of his films are sometimes criticized as chamber dramas, but I believe he has made the city, the urban space, to enter the chamber and dwell there. And the politics of living within urban space of a neocolonial world is, is very much his focus in all his films. And the book deals with those issues as well. Not just identities, the book also talks about the idea of the new metropolis. The book talks about the idea of developing a new aesthetics to address the changing scenario of middle class life in a city. So he is a very much an urban director, if I put it that way. His politics revolved around the metropolis, and he was constantly inserting iconoclastic, radical political ideas within the lived space of the middle class home. So that way his films, and of course the book which focuses on it, I think it will be an important contribution to the idea of the new middle class, the new city, the neocolonial regime, and of course, definitely feminist and queer identities.
Should we open the floor for discussions and questions? If any one of you would like to ask any question about Rituparno, his work, the kind of things that the book deals with, any, even cinema for that matter, and Bengali cinema, and there's, I can see a hand over there. If the microphone could be passed to this gentleman. Has just stood up with a, yeah.
Hello, sir. Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello. Hello, sir. Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, I had this question that we talk about parallel cinema and art house film, and then there's commercial films. So we've seen that Rituparno Ghosh has won the National Award several times. And most of the times, these art movies and parallel cinemas win more awards, like prestigious national awards, then more than the national films. Like the way Chitrangada had a commercial impact, commercial income, I would say. It was not like Chaande Pahad or something like, Happy New Year from Shahrukh Khan or something like that. So when will the time come in India when films like these art movies or parallel movies will not be considered as parallel movies, but they will become actually commercial and people appreciate those movies, but I don't understand why it is like that in India.
Okay. Would you like to respond?
I don't think that there is something called art cinema anymore. With the coming of the multiplexes, the division between art and commercial cinema has been blurred to a very great extent. And I believe when these films are made, they're made for a certain target audience. As I was saying just now, that there is of course an urban audience, and within the urban audience, there is also a classification.
For instance, there was a time when art house films, which were known as art house films, did not have any audience at all. But with the coming of the multiplexes, with the construction of a niche urban audience, these films started doing well. In fact, within urban spaces. Now, if your question is that whether these films which will get pan-Indian acceptance, then I would say, well, for that we need a more educated audience. Audience would be able to appreciate that kind of cinema. I believe, you know, many of us, wherever we come from, whichever corner of the country, I think these filmmakers, if you at all can label them as art house filmmakers, they assume a certain degree of education, a certain degree of cultural awareness, and also a certain degree of viewership. You need to make people more aware of a certain kind of cinema with which they might not be habituated. So these films need to be distributed more, but I don't know whether that's a realistic thing to do. Yes, of course. So.
Okay, just to add to what Kaustav said, I think we should just throw this argument back to you, because really it is the young audience and the audience that India is manufacturing in a way that is going to decide whether you're going to see bad cinema or good cinema. And throughout the festival here, we've been dealing with these ideas about inequality, increasing inequality in social classes, in the economy of the country. We're dealing with the dissonance between and the divide between rural India and urban India. These are larger discourses. And within these, if you set what is happening to film industry, and when you go to see a film, is it just the idea of flat entertainment, of watching a hero and a heroine and wonderful songs, and you go back with really nothing to go with you, as opposed to the idea that all of us come to cinema with a certain sense of cinema literacy, with a certain sense of cinema appreciation, and that you go away with something which I would call residual, something stays with you. It makes you think. Cinema doesn't, you know, it can't bring revolutionary change in a day in a democracy like ours, but we can all engage with more critically and demand better cinema, and you will get it. It's not about alternate cinema. It is about more meaningful cinema, just as any other art form should really have a relevance to the reality which you live and perceive.
Any other questions? I can see a hand there.
Hello. Yeah, I want to ask that, like, you guys are talking about, like, how these movies are impacting urban people, or these people are watching these movies. So, don't you think that these movies should be watched more by the other section of the society who basically needs to get more impacted from these issues? Because urban people have started talking about these topics like LGBT and other things more openly than, you know, rural background of people. That's my question.
Yeah, the point is, yeah, exactly. In fact, let me tell you this, Rituparno Ghosh's films made a huge impact on the rural audience. In fact, when we were doing our ethnography across Bengal, we found that Rituparno Ghosh has been a cultural icon to a lot of queer identified people who had never seen the city of Kolkata. Yes, and when we, for instance, in places like, very small places like Bardhaman, places like Durgapur, Rituparno Ghosh was already a cultural icon. And because Bengal did not have a queer icon before Ritu, he became a political figure who, for instance, there are a lot of people, as you talk about the urban space of LGBT movement, there are hundreds of people who do not really come out and identify themselves as queer or walk the Pride March, but they were getting a kind of a cultural exposure through Ritu's films, which were circulated widely in West Bengal and also other parts of India. Wherever we have gone, in Bombay, wherever, even in Bangalore, I have seen people have been hugely impacted by his films. Now, these are urban spaces, but if you go to the even to the interiors of Bengal, Rituparno Ghosh is an iconic figure even there. So I believe that is one part of the story which has not been told. And maybe, you know, a documentary or something like that might just, you know, kind of...
I just want to add to that, you know, and I have a different logic to your question, and perhaps it will answer it more appropriately. It's in actually the essay that I have written in the book deals with this, exactly with this issue, and I think Ritu is a very important figure who not only understood the language of cinema and the art of filmmaking, but also understood that cinema is an extremely commercial art. It has to be produced with money, and after that, it has also to be distributed, it has to be exhibited. And he understood that how important distribution and exhibition was. And therefore, in the second and third phase of his career, he actually tied up with leading major production houses of Bengal. And a lot of his work was actually even produced by producers from Bombay. So what happened was they were able to take the films to the hinterlands, to the rural areas, because they had the money. So they could make prints, or they could exhibit the film even in smaller theaters. They could also show the films in television. So they could release. What happened during the 70s or the 80s, even till the 90s, was that parallel cinema made by the so-called art filmmakers and funded by government bodies, those films were not getting exhibited because nobody was ready to distribute those films, and exhibitors wouldn't take those films because they knew that, I mean, there were no prints available for those films. So there was absolutely an absence of a circuit of distribution and exhibition, which Rituparno understood. And therefore, his partnership with leading production houses like Sri Venkatesh Films, which is like a major corporate film production house, almost like the Yashraj or the Dharmas of Bollywood, he partnered with them. So they made several, they could really distribute and exhibit the film in every corner of the state, not just Bengal, but take it outside Bengal, release it there, also, release it outside India. So I think that perhaps would answer your question. Should we take one more? We have a hand.
Let's take two very short ones. There's a young lady here.
And then.
Hi, this is very specific to the book. I just want to know if the book talks about Abhoman as a film, like how he started with Radha Krishna and then Girish Ghosh and Binodini, and then the romance between Aniket and Shrimati. So does it actually talk about, like, does it focus on Abhoman in any essay or any article?
Yeah, I've just said my essay focuses. It's the first essay in the book after our introduction, which is a long analytical essay on Abhoman, on the themes that you talked about, and on the very masterful writing that Rituparno had, where increasingly his writing was becoming so layered that if you had an understanding of Indian culture, he was bringing in the tropes of Radha Krishna, he was bringing in theatre and Noti Binodini, and he was also talking about the Satyajit Ray history, personal history. So he's locating your narrative and making you travel to many spaces at the same time, and really creating very rich texts. So that's what the essay is about. And as I said, there are other analytical essays in the first half of the book. And in the second half, it gets more interesting because we have two long interviews with the filmmaker, with Rituparno Ghosh, and we have interviews with some of his cast and crew. So he's worked with all the major talent, as I said, and some of his favorite actors like Sharmila Tagore, Aparna Sen, who was also a big influence, cinematic influence, and Jaya Bachchan. There are these personalities who've given their interviews and impressions about working with Ritu. So I hope you'll enjoy the book.
And just to add to that a little, to your question on Radha Krishna, we have also focused on how Ritu reappropriated the Radha Krishna myth to narrate queer narratives. That he reappropriated the love story to retell gay love stories also. Yeah.
Hi everybody, I'm Kalpana. Like you talked about the Rituparno Ghosh sexual identity, but in India, still homosexuals haven't come out of the closet, and law doesn't support them. So what do you feel about it?
Of course, because the law has never supported, it has supported homosexuality, but then they overturned the law. But the whole point is that because it is still a closeted affair, because it is quote-unquote illegitimate, these films definitely had a major impact on the perception of LGBT people. Because cinema being an extremely powerful medium, it is important to channelize certain ideas which are considered illegitimate. And Ritu's films definitely had a huge impact in bringing homosexuality out of the closet to dwell on the middle class dining room. That has been done in film after film. So that way his films were extremely political. They were making a definitely a very, very strong political statement.